Take your Bible and turn with me to Romans chapter 12, chapter 13. We were in chapter 12 for such a long time, and we needed to walk our way through those ways of love. My mind still races there as I think now of chapter 13, but we're in Romans chapter 13. And this morning I've entitled the message, Seeking the Welfare of the City. Seeking the Welfare of the City. Romans chapter 13. We'll begin our reading at verse 1. If you do not have a Bible, just raise your hand. We will gladly bring you one. We would like everyone to follow along as we seek to study God's Word right up here. All right. Thank you. Romans chapter 13, let's begin our reading now in verse 1. Are you ready for the scripture? Amen. Every person is to be in subjection to governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God, and those which exist are established by God. Verse 2, therefore, whoever resists authority has opposed the ordinance of God, and they who have opposed will receive condemnation upon themselves. Verse 3, for rulers are not a cause of fear for good behavior, but for evil. Do you want to have no fear of authority? Do what is good, and you will have praise from the same. For it is a minister of God to you for good. But if you do what is evil, be afraid. For it does not bear the sword for nothing. For it is a minister of God, an avenger who brings wrath on the one who practices evil. Verse 5. For that reason, or therefore, it is necessary to be in subjection, not only because of wrath, but also for conscience' sake. For because of this, you also pay taxes. For rulers are servants of God, devoting themselves to this very thing. Now verse 7. Render to all what is due them. Tax to whom tax is due. Custom to whom custom. Fear to whom fear. And then notice, honor to whom honor. Lord, we now pray and ask for the grace of the illuminating work of the Spirit of God in our own hearts and minds. Be with my mouth, be with our ears, be with our hearts as we come to your holy word. May it transform us as we believe. We pray this in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Her name was Marguerite Johnson. Chances are you don't know that name. But Marguerite Johnson lived a horrific life. Early on, her father abandoned her. Her mother then got into a relationship with a man, and her mother's boyfriend sexually assaulted her and abused her. Her mother found Marguerite to be way too much of an inconvenience on her life, so she dropped young Marguerite off at her grandmother's house in Stamps, Arkansas. Marguerite Johnson, at the age of 8, was so overwhelmed. I mean, 8 years old. So overwhelmed that she shut down. Literally, physically, emotionally, she shut down. She became a mute. People tried to encourage young Marguerite to speak, but to no avail, until one day, One of the town's most distinguished Christian ladies began to reach out to her. She invited young Marguerite to her home. And as Marguerite went to this Christian lady's home, her nose was arrested by the smell of fresh baked cookies. Mrs. Flowers was her name. She was a very distinguished woman. She did not stand to gain anything from young Marguerite's life. But she served her cookies and hot tea. And she talked to her. After about an hour, there was no advance, and so young Marguerite left, but came back the next day for some more cookies and tea. This happened over and over and over again until at last, young Marguerite slowly began to speak. And speak she did. See, you don't know her as Marguerite Johnson, because when she got older, she changed her name to Maya Angelou. This woman, this prolific poet who actually made a living off of the use of words. Now, what changed this young woman from an abused, abandoned mute to a prolific writer who wrote such wonderful, wonderful poems like I Know Why the Cage Bird Sings, was love, kindness, shoe leather Christianity. Someone decided to practice that in her life and use that to open this young girl's mind and heart to the truth about Jesus Christ. What was used to help to transform this lady was the kindness of hot coals that we learned about in chapter 12, which changed her disposition. My question for you this morning is this: does this same gospel, does that same shoe leather kind of living, does it work in Iran, in Syria? Does it work in Russia and in China? Does it work in Cuba? Does this same gospel message with that same kind of shoe leather living work in Uganda? Does it work, let's bring it closer to home, in Brooklyn? Does it work in Watts? Does it work down the street in Matthew Henson here in our city? Does it work in your neighborhood and in mine? The good news that Paul has been seeking to teach us in this wonderful book is that there is no place where the gospel does not work. The Bible teaches that it is a wonderful thing to be a Christian. Why? Because there is no circumstances, no situation, no environment, no nation, no condition in which the gospel does not work. Now, Sinclair Ferguson affirms this truth when he says, the gospel works if you're rich and if you're poor. If you are educated and if you have little or no education at all. The gospel works in the West and the gospel works in the East. The gospel works in the North and in the South. There is no form of political government imaginable on our planet in which the gospel does not work. It works in a monarchy. It works in a republic. It works in an oligarchy. And it also works in a democracy. It works under Marxist communism. And the gospel works in lands dominated by Islam. The gospel works everywhere. The question that Paul answers for us in our text is this: how should a believer live under unfriendly governmental rule? How does the believer live when the government is unfriendly toward the gospel? Now, Paul has already shown us how the gospel works in every conceivable circumstance. You remember in chapter 12, beginning in verses 1 down through verse 3, he taught us that the gospel works in our relationship with God. It leads us to present ourselves as a living sacrifice. He taught us how the gospel works in the community of faith. He gave us those 12 ways of love, that it works. It actually works in the church. He has shown us at the end of chapter 12 how the gospel works in relationship to our non-Christian friends, our enemies. He tells us how it works. Now, he teaches us how it works under governing authorities. I want to tease out from these verses three clear positions which these verses teach us concerning how to live under the government in which we exist. We are taught in this text three things. Number one, we're taught that ultimate authority belongs to God. Number two, we're taught that God delegates some of his authority. And number three, we're taught that resisting authority is to resist God. Now, the best way for us to understand this text is to understand the setting in which it is given. The political situation in Rome was difficult, to say the least. The Roman Emperor Claudius had earlier expelled Jews because of a dispute concerning a certain Christus, who writers of antiquity tell us was Christ himself. Although the Jews had returned to Rome, the political situation was politically and potentially volatile. According to Paul, and history, shall I say, Paul was concerned about a group of Jews known as zealots. They held this kind of revolutionary attitude toward the government of Rome. Now, Paul does not, write this down somewhere, Paul does not instruct believers on what we ought to do when a government departs from its role given by God. He does not instruct us about that. He does not even specifically explain what to do when our government is committing moral wrong. He does not explain that, i.e. Nazi Germany or many other places. Neither are we told in this text what to do in the midst of revolution. Paul does not address that. Furthermore, Paul in this text, write this down somewhere, does not hold up one form of government over another. He does not explain that a monarchy is better than a democracy or so on and so forth. He doesn't get into any of that. Paul understands that when Jesus comes back, he will neither be riding on the back of donkeys nor elephants, but he is an independent, he is Lord and God of all. Paul understands that. He is speaking in broad, general terms about all human government anywhere in the world. Now, if we keep these thoughts in mind, let me repeat some of them. First of all, that he is not telling us what to do when a government departs from its role given by God, or he's not telling us what to do when our government commits moral wrong, and he's not telling us that one form of government is better than another. If we keep that in mind, it will help us to avoid the interpretive danger of reading into the text what Paul does not say. Having said all that now, let's now look at the text. The first thing we're told is that ultimate authority belongs to God. Verse 1. Every person is to be in subjection to governing authorities. For there is no authority except from God. And those which exist are established by God. What Paul is saying to us here in the beginning of verse 1, and really this truth is found throughout all the Bible, throughout all of Scripture, is this: that authority is one of God's ideas. Authority is one of God's ideas. It was God Himself who created authority. One of the ways that you can discern what the Holy Spirit means by what He reveals in the text of Scripture is to look for repeated words throughout the text. And if you just let your eyes race through verses 1 through 7, you'll notice very carefully that the word authority is used at least 5 times in the New American Standard. You'll see it: authority, 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 authority. In the NIV, it's used about 7 times. And so when the Holy Spirit is repeating phrases, it is clear that He is pressing upon us a theme of authority. He is pressing it on us. How are we to relate to authority? Now, this theme is very relevant to us, is it not? Oh, yes, it is. Because we see in our culture and even across the world that there is an avalanche of rebellion against authority. We see rebellion against authority in the church. That's right, in the church. People who claim to be Christians, they claim to know Christ, but they're abandoning authority in all sorts of ways. But the chief way that you see it in the church is that they abandon the authority of Scripture. Scripture is not the one sole only authoritative factor for determining belief and conduct for them. But they say, yes, I believe in Scripture, but something else too. And so we see this rebellion against authority in the church. We see this rebellion against authority in our culture's departure from the law. We are happy to obey laws that we agree with. But suddenly, all of a sudden, we decide, if you will, that that's a law that we don't like. And then we act as if we are free to break it. And we see that all across our culture right now. We see rebellion against authority in the world of education. There's a complete abandonment and departure from the authority of truth. Just of truth. In other words, truth is no longer God's standard of right and wrong. But in the world of education, well, you may feel like that's truth for you, but it's not truth for me. In the world of academics and in the world of education, what you see that's happening is relativism, where now people, professors, students say, yeah, that may be true for you, but it's not true for me. And it's all based upon subjectivity, what's inside, not objective truth, or as Francis Schaeffer called it, true truth. No, we make that determination based upon what we feel to be true. And we see a departure from that in the world of education. We see rebellion against authority even in the home. In the home. In every form. We see in the homes, whether they be Christian homes or not, where wives are reversing the order, where husbands are not leading but giving it up or abusing that lead. We see where children don't even know what is what because they've never seen a clear model. And we see a rebellion against authority even in the home. We see this rebellion against authority in schools. No doubt about it. I was talking to one teacher recently who said she spends so much time just trying to parent and not even teach her subject. Because kids are struggling just to even pay attention, and they need so much help personally. And we see this sense of rebellion against authority in the schools all across our nation. Well, someone might be thinking, Pastor, you know, that's old school thinking, this whole idea of authority. That's old school thinking. You know, Paul didn't know what he was talking about. Well, Paul did not live in the day of the Hitlers and the Stalins and the Mubaraks, but keep in mind, Paul is writing not from the background of a Christian government. Paul is writing from the background and the context of some of the most cruel emperors and leaders known to mankind. Caligula, Nero, Domitian. All of these rulers were worse than some of the other leaders that I mentioned earlier of Hitler and Stalin. Paul is not writing from a Christian context. As a matter of fact, Eric Alexander called the corruption that Paul saw in his day, he called it corruption in the extreme. I mean, it was extremely corrupt. And so Paul is not writing from an ideal context. He is writing to say to us that ultimate authority belongs to God and to God alone. Now, that does not mean that God approves of the way in which people exercise authority. It does not mean that God approves of any wickedness or any corruption, whether of the emperors in that day or leaders in our day. What's my proof for this? Well, let's look at a couple of passages. Turn with me to Lamentations chapter 3. Lamentations chapter 3. It's right behind the book of Jeremiah in the Old Testament. Lamentations chapter 3. God does not approve of wickedness and corruption in leadership in any form. Lamentations chapter 3. It's that wonderful chapter that tells us that God's loving kindness is indeed never cease, his compassions never fail in verse 22. But I want you to let your eyes slide down the page of Lamentations 3 and let it come down to verse 31. Let's start there. For the Lord will not reject forever. Y'all got it? Lamentations 3:31. For if he causes grief, then he will have compassion, according to his abundant loving kindness. You see, the wickedness of man cannot frustrate or cloud the purposes of God's omniscience. Verse 33, for he does not afflict willingly or grieve the sons of men to crush under his feet all the prisoners of the land, to deprive a man of justice in the presence of the Most High, to defraud a man in his lawsuit of these things. The Lord does not approve. You see, he does not approve of wickedness in any system. Turn with me to Habakkuk chapter 1. You start turning to the right. It's that part of your Old Testament that has the pages stuck together right there near the front of the New Testament. Habakkuk chapter 1, verse 13. As we come to Habakkuk chapter 1, Habakkuk speaks of God's nature. And he says, beginning in verse 12, Habakkuk chapter 1, verse 12, are you not from everlasting, O Lord, my God, my Holy One? We will not die. You, O Lord, have appointed them to judge. They were being raided by another nation that God had actually raised up to judge them. But then notice what it says here in verse 12, the end of verse 12. Oh, and you, O rock, have established them to correct. But verse 13, although God had raised up this nation to judge his people, notice what he says about God's character. Your eyes are too pure to approve evil. And you cannot look on wickedness with what? With favor. Although God was using a wicked nation to judge his own people, God did not approve of those people who were doing it. We come back to this issue. Now back to Romans 13. That ultimate authority belongs to God. And just because God allows some government or authority to be in place does not mean that God approves of them. Y'all got that point? But this does not alter the fact that God is the one who established and created authority. Now, here's the question that I want you to learn to ask of the Bible on a regular basis. And don't ask it with a sarcastic tone, but with a curious tone. Ask the question, why? Why? Why did you create authority, God? Why did you establish authority? And when you read the Bible, you discover from the very beginning that God created and establishes authority for two reasons. Number one, because we are creatures, not creators. Right from the beginning of the book of Genesis, God establishes authority over human beings, and he does so because we are creatures, and we have a need of relating to authority outside of ourselves. Let me put it plainly. We need someone to tell us how to live because we're creatures. We're not creators. We don't understand life. We don't know what we're supposed to do by nature. We're creatures. Why did God have to tell our first parents, who were innocent? He had to tell them, of this tree, you can eat. Of this one, do not touch. Why did he have to tell them that? Because they were creatures. They needed someone to give them instruction on how to live. This is actually the teaching of Genesis 1 and 2, that God exercises authority over us. He provides guidance to us. Why? Because we are. See, you were supposed to fill in the blank right there. We are creatures, not creators. We are managers, not owners. But we see something else in the book of Exodus. When we come a little bit further in the book of Exodus, we discover that God not only exercises authority over us because we're creatures, but we discover that he exercises authority over us because we are sinners. We are sinners in a fallen condition, which means that our thinking is distorted. It means that our will is incapable of doing certain things. It means that if God does not come along and give us his holy law, we will actually destroy ourselves. And that's what the Ten Commandments actually does. The Ten Commandments is designed to preserve chaos so that chaos doesn't break out in the world. Because we are sinners in a fallen condition. And so whenever we rebel against authority, we're actually rebelling against two things. We're rebelling against our creatureliness, and we're rebelling against our fallenness. Did y'all get that? So critical to our understanding of authority is that we have a proper doctrine of man, that we understand who is man and what is man? Who is man? He's a creature. What is man? Man is a fallen creature. And he needs someone to help him because he has a built-in bias of rebellion against authority. It's just built in. It's there. All of this is to say that ultimate authority belongs to God. Look at it in the text again. For there is no authority, Romans 13, verse 1. Every person is to be in subjection to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God. And those which exist are established by God. There's only one ultimate authority in the whole universe. This is actually what Jesus meant in Matthew chapter 28 when he said, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth." There is only one ultimate authority in the universe that is universal and that is absolute. And it's God. It's God. Now we'll see in a moment that there are other authorities, but there is only one that is ultimate. There's only one that is absolute. There's only one that is universal. For instance, the Parliament and the Queen of England, they have certain authority in the UK, in the British Empire, but it only goes so far. You see, they can't come over here and exercise authority. Their authority is limited. The Premier of Russia, Putin, has a certain authority in Russia. But his authority is limited. It only goes so far. Our president has a certain authority, but it's limited. It can only go so far. But according to God's word, God's authority is universal. It's everywhere. It applies to all men. It is absolute. And listen, the Bible teaches that God's authority will one day be visible. And because it's not, quote, visible where people can see it, they feel like they can rebel against it all the more. But the Bible says one day his authority, his absolute universal authority will be visible. When and how will it be made visible? Well, when Jesus comes. The Bible says that every knee shall bow. And every tongue confess that he is Lord. So in summary of this first point, the authority of God is ultimate. It is absolute. It is universal. And one day it will be visible. But we need authority because we are creatures. And because we're sinners. Number two, we're taught in this text that God delegates some of his authority. We see this in verse 1. Every person is to be in subjection to governing authorities, for there's no authority except from God, and those which exist are established by God. Let your eyes drop down to verse 4. For it is a minister of God to you for good. But if you do what is evil, be afraid, for it does not bear the sword for nothing. For it is a minister of God, an avenger who brings wrath on the one who practices what? Evil. Verse 6. For because of this you also pay taxes, for rulers are servants of God. They're servants of God, civil authorities under the providence of God have been given delegated authority by God himself. In verse 4, when it speaks of it, that's speaking of civil authorities, it's a minister of God. Again, in verse 4, it's a minister of God. In verse 6, rulers are servants of God. The phrase established by at the end of verse 1, underline it in your Bible. That phrase means to draw up in order, to arrange, to assign, to dispose a certain position, to allot a particular task. Human government is an institution brought into being for the regulation of human affairs by God. By God. Now, what is clear from these verses is that God does delegate some of his authority. That's what's very clear. Now, we wouldn't have known this by reading Genesis 1 and 2. For when we read Genesis 1 and 2, you remember when God made man to rule, right? He was to rule over everything. Over the fish, over the birds of the sky, over all the creatures of the earth, man was made to have authority over creation. He was sort of like a vice regent. Man was delegated authority by God in order to rule over his creation. Now, there are three arenas in which God has a delegated authority, in which God has delegated authority. Three arenas: the home, the church, and the state. Let's write those down. There are three areas or arenas in which God has delegated authority. And God has given explicit instruction concerning how they are to operate. Number one, the home or the family. Number two, the church. And number three, the state. Now, you could probably expand on the one in the state by writing down in the employer-employee relationship, because God gives specific directions about how we are to respond to our employers. But there is a structure. There is a pecking order, and you must not ignore it. There is a delegated authority that is important for us to grasp. Now, what's the proof of it? What's the proof of these structures, these areas where there is authority? Well, it's right in the Word of God. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 1. What do we read there? In Ephesians 6, 1, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Look at Ephesians chapter 6, verse 5. Slaves, be obedient to those who are your masters, according to the flesh, with fear and trembling, in the sincerity of your heart, as to Christ. We just read here in Romans 13, 1. Every person is to be in subjection to the governing authorities. We also see in the Gospels where that evil government, headed in some sense by Pilate, unjustly crucified our Lord. And you recall what Jesus said to him? Jesus said that you would have no authority over me unless it had been given to you by my Father. That was an evil government, and yet God gave them the authority. And Jesus, even himself, did not rebel against it. Paul tells us in Romans chapter 9 that God actually raised up Pharaoh, that wicked, hard-hearted king, and set him on the throne of Egypt. God did that. You read the book of Daniel, and you discover, even the book of Jeremiah, that Nebuchadnezzar, the most powerful ruler in the world at that time, was God's servant. Cyrus was God's servant. So it's important for us to remember that just because God allows evil rulers does not mean he approves of them. Can you make that distinction in your mind? God delegates some of his authority within the very structures of life, and we must accept it if we're going to be in the will of God. Last point. Resisting authority is to resist God. This is perhaps the most difficult point to grasp, and it's probably the most vulnerable to misinterpretation. But go to Romans now, Romans 13, verse 2, and notice what Paul says. Paul says in verse 2, therefore, whoever, did you see it? Whoever, which means? Yeah, it means you too. It means me. Whoever resists authority has opposed the ordinance of God. And they who have opposed will receive condemnation upon themselves. Can you accept that? Can you accept? I know where many of you are going. I'm going to get to that question in just a moment, okay? Some of you are already down the street and up the corner. Well, what if the government asks us? Wait a minute, I'm going to get to that. Just let's accept what's here. Let's accept what's here. The scripture teaches that when authority is properly constituted and rebelled against, we are actually rebelling against God. It displeases God. We have some biblical examples of this. When God gave a certain delegated authority to Moses in the Old Testament in the book of Numbers chapter 6, when Korah rebelled against Moses, God was angered. He was angered. Korah refused to subject himself to Moses' authority, and had not Aaron stepped up and intervened by making atonement for the people, the entire congregation would have been annihilated. God was angry when they rebelled against his authority. Again, God, for his own purposes, places sometimes wicked men in positions of power. Nebuchadnezzar, Pharaoh, do you recognize that the man who wrote this very book, Paul, was executed under whose authority? Under God's authority, but under Nero's empire. And there is not one word in this letter where Paul counsels us to rebel against authority. He said, Pastor, is there any exception? Obviously there is. There is exceptions because when human laws demand disobedience to God's laws, then we know what to do. And I'll explain that in just a moment. However, let us be clear that when we resist authority that has been properly constituted, we rebel against God. I'm speaking to some of you right now who you're under the authority of someone who is mean to you. I'm speaking to some wives who have unsaved husbands. I'm speaking to some kids who have some mean-spirited parents, and you're under their authority. I'm speaking to some folks who work for cranky bosses. I'm speaking to some students who are under cranky teachers who just can't wait until the semester is over because they are just whatever. Some of you have to work with people you can't stand. We're in church now. You can't stand them. You have to live with some people who disrespect you. They disrespect you all the time, but you have to live with them. Some of us have been made to suffer under a government that consistently promotes evil. The question is, what do you do? What do you do? All right, I want to answer these questions in closing. There are four critical questions that we need to answer that will bring the teaching of this text into our lives. And the first question is this: how far can a Christian go in expressing opposition to an unjust government? Just how far can we go? Answer: as far as the laws allow us to go. As far as the laws allow us to go. But when you start breaking law in the name of opposing governments, you've crossed the line. But there are many ways to oppose an unjust government and be lawful at the same time. Number two, what should Christians do if the government orders them to do something that conflicts with their faith? Well, we're clear about that answer, aren't we? We obey God rather than men. We have examples of this, clear examples of this in the Word of God. You go all the way back to the Old Testament and you look in the book of Exodus. Do you remember that account when the Pharaoh came into power? Oh, no, you're not familiar with that account. Turn with me, if you will, Exodus chapter 1. First book in the Bible is the book of Genesis. Right after that is Exodus. Exodus chapter 1. Here's an account where we have a clear example of what we should do if the government orders us to do something that conflicts with our faith. Exodus chapter 1, beginning in verse 8. Now a new king arose over Egypt who did not know Joseph. In other words, he had no relationship with Joseph. Verse 9. And he said to his people, "Behold, the people of the sons of Israel are more and mightier than we." Verse 10, "Come, let us deal wisely with them, or else they will multiply, and in the event of war, they will also join themselves to those who hate us and fight against us and depart from the land." Verse 11, "So they appointed taskmasters over them to afflict them with hard labor. And they built for Pharaoh storage in Python and Ramses." Verse 12, "But the more they afflicted them, the more they multiplied, and the more they spread out, so that they were in dread of the sons of Israel." Verse 13, "The Egyptians compelled the sons of Israel to labor rigorously." Verse 14, "And they made their lives" what? "Bitter." That's what actually the word Egypt means, bitter, bitter. "With hard labor and mortar and bricks and all kinds of labor in the field, and their labors which they had rigorously imposed on them." Verse 15, "Then the king of Egypt spoke to the Hebrew midwives, one of whom which was named Shiprah, and the other was named Puah." Verse 16, "And he said, when you are helping the Hebrew women to give birth, and see them upon their birth stool, if it is a son, then you shall put him to death. But if it is a daughter, then she shall live." That was an evil plan, wasn't it? That was an evil plan. Verse 17, "But the midwives feared God." You see it? Verse 17. "And did not do as the king of Egypt had commanded them, but let the boys live. So the king of Egypt called for the midwives and said to them, 'Why have you done this thing and let the boys live?' Well, they told a fib, but I can't explain why, what happens afterwards, but just let's read the text. Verse 19, "The midwives said to Pharaoh, 'Because the Hebrew women are not as the Egyptian women, for they are vigorous and give birth before the midwives can get to them.'" Now, they lied, right? But let's look at the next verse. "So God was good to the midwives, And the people multiplied and became very mighty. Now, don't you get the impression that if you lie for a good cause, that God will bless you? The scripture just gives us the reality here of what God did. Verse 21, because the midwives feared God, he established households for them. So we have an occasion here in the Old Testament where God said, kill these babies. And these midwives said, no. No, we have an example of this. We have another example of this in the book of Daniel. I won't read through that text, but Shadrach, Meshach, and that bad Negro, or Abednego is his name. He refused now to bow down to that image of gold, right? And these Hebrew boys refused to bow down, and God kept them. But we also have an example in Acts chapter 5, verse 29. When Peter and John were told to stop preaching the gospel of Christ, and they said, we must obey God rather than men. We must obey God rather than men. All right, so what we have answered so far is two important questions. How far can a Christian go in expressing opposition to an unjust government as far as the law? Number two, what should Christians do if the government orders them to do something that conflicts with their faith? We should obey God rather than men. Number three, what about civil disobedience? What about civil disobedience? Hear me, church. The Word of God is very clear that God is the controlling force behind every government on earth without exception. God is. And therefore, it isn't man's elections or man's revolutions that's going to determine the governments on earth. God is behind it all. And so if you think that elections will change the plan of God, it will not. The processes of revolution on earth are there. Nevertheless, it is not elections or revolutions who determines the seats of power. God does. God does. I said God does. You see, God uses in his own elective providence and in his own eternal plan people, instruments of his own choosing, whether they be good or whether they be evil, whether they are tyrants or whether they are benevolent and loving rulers. God orders the powers according to his will. And if you stumble with that, it's just because you don't see the power behind the powers. If you struggle with that, it's because you don't recognize that God is sovereign over all. You see, beyond the government, there is God. Beyond the White House, there is heaven's throne. And we ought to believe what we read in the Bible more than we read in the newspapers. We read the newspapers as if this on the same level with the Word of God, and it's not. The Word of God teaches clearly that it is God who is in control of all things, working all things according to his holy and righteous purpose. And every government that exists is held in God's hand. In God's hands. And it will only go as far as God permits it, because it has been established by God. So what about civil disobedience? If you're thinking civil disobedience is actually going to change the world. You're just trying to usurp the purposes of God. Remember this. In history, I'm almost through. In history, the gospel has flourished under the most oppressive governments. Flourished. I don't know why. That's what you see in history. It spreads under the most oppressive governments. And if you study the history of man, you will also understand that the history of every nation on earth, every nation began with either a coup, bloodshed, or murder. Every nation started that way. But there's only one nation that was started by God, one nation that was started by God. And it too started with bloodshed. God's own son was murdered. God gave up his son for our sin, that he might make of us a different kind of nation, a holy nation, a nation that's different than any nation on the earth, who doesn't have to pick up swords and guns to fight. But we are equipped with the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ in prayer. And we can shake the world by just fulfilling our purposes. We don't have to fight like the world fights. But we can fight on our knees. And we can fight with the sword of God's word and make a difference. So what does it mean to be a good Christian and a good citizen? Well, my time is up. Let me give you three things. You can read these verses later. According to Titus chapter 3, verses 1 and 2, don't rebel. Submit to God and to trust him. Submit to God and trust him. Titus chapter 3, verses 1 and 2 makes that very, very clear. Don't rebel. Submit to God. Submit and trust God. Number two, don't complain. But pray. Pray and participate. 1 Timothy chapter 2 makes it very clear that we're to be praying for those who are in authority over us, and we are to participate in the process. But if you spend more time complaining than you do praying, you ought to stop. God wants us to seek the good of the city. And if we don't care enough for those who lead us to pray for them, we ought to stop complaining. Pray. Participate. Do good. That's what the government really wants. That's part of its purpose, is to affirm those who do good, to punish those who do evil. Do something about the welfare problem. Why don't you go help somebody find a job? Help them. Invite them into your home. Feed them. Talk with them. Rather than just ranting against the system. 1 Peter, which we read at the beginning of our services, tell us to give, to serve, to love, to submit. 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 13 through 20. I end with this truth here. The Bible says that the government will ultimately rest upon whose shoulders? His. There's a image of, it's in New York City, I believe, of Atlas, right? Strong man, right? And he has the world on his shoulders, right? He's holding it there. It gives the impression that man can somehow keep things together. But man can never keep the world together. But there is one whose shoulders is big enough. And the government rests on his shoulders. And his name is called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. And our God has the whole world in his hands. He got the little bitty baby in his hands. He has you and me, brother, in his hands. He got the whole world in his hands. Yes? Can I get a witness in here? So, Lord, under your providences, we confess that there are injustices, some of which, Lord, we wish, we pray, would change. We see the injustices. We see the disparity. We see the oppression. We feel the pressure. And yet, Lord, we're told clearly in this text that ultimate authority belongs to you, and you've given your authority to some. And we ought not to resist authority. Lord, we have not yet been put in a position where we have had to shed blood. But if that time comes, help us to be willing. Until that day, help us to seek the welfare of the city. Help us to do good, to live right, and to participate and to pray. Help us to apply the things that we've heard. Help us to submit to the authorities that you've placed us under. Whether it's a boss or a husband or a parent, help us. We'll be very careful to give you the praise and glory. In Jesus' name.